The first person that alerted me to Louise Penny and made me realize that she was a bit of a thing was my mother. No. My aunt had fallen and broken her ankle and had put out just a casual call on Facebook for good books to read. Lots of people wrote in suggestions. My mom's was Louise Penny. My aunt thanked everyone for the suggestions and said she'd look into them. My mother wrote again and offered to send her the entire series to my aunt, who lived in London. My aunt again commented on the thread and said she'd see if she could pick them up in a bookstore in London. My mother wrote again, this time in all capital letters, with emoticons, and said, "Lucy, you do not understand. You need these books. They will cure you." My aunt was up and walking in just 3 weeks after reading the entire series. So my mother was apparently right about this as everything. Thank you, Mom. The next person that preached Louise Penny to me is one of the only people that I trust as much as my mother, Stephen King. At his event at Lisner last year, as he was signing hundreds and hundreds of books for a sold-out crowd, he looked over at me. "Liz," he said to me over his little glasses, "what do you read?" Before I had a chance to come up with something just very glamorous to impress Stephen King, he immediately cut me off. "I'll tell you what I read. I read Louise Penny." "It's just so great," he said. Everything is going along so well, and everyone is so nice and charming, and all of these great Canadian characters, and then someone suddenly gets brutally murdered with an axe. I love it. But both my mom's and Stephen King's devotion and description get to the heart of what makes Louise's work so poignant and so popular with readers. It deals with both lightness and darkness, and every character has these different, complex parts of themselves. No one is all one or the other. And of course, we know the books are steeped in the smells, feel, and people of Quebec. As Louise herself writes, "They're definitely crime fiction, but they're love letters to the place I choose to live. I could live anywhere in the world, and I choose to live in the eastern townships of Quebec." She's, of course, won numerous awards for her work, including the Agatha Award for Best Mystery Novel, four consecutive years, and the Anthony Award for Best Novel of 5 times. I don't want to say too much about the newest book, because I know that you've all just gotten your copies. So let's cut to the chase and welcome Louise Penny to the Willard Literary Series.
Suddenly, a bang rang out. Oh, thank you so much for coming out. I'm so thrilled. Before I get, ramble on, I want to thank Politics and Prose, one of the great independent bookstores in the nation. I want to thank Liz's mom. Liz's mom is over there, right? There you go. the other thing before I launch into what will no doubt be a riveting discussion. I want to mention, since most of you are probably fans of crime writing, is that correct? I just want to ask, because you have one of my favorite events in the world happens in the Washington area, and that's called Malice Domestic. Are you familiar with that? There's the board of directors of Malice Domestic happens to be here today, so. Isn't that a great name, too? Malice Domestic. So I want to thank them. They were supporters of the series long before anyone else even knew that Armand and Clara and Three Pines existed. So I have a soft spot in my heart forever for Malice. So go figure out that sentence. Out of context, it would make no sense at all. I also want to say how very pleased I am to have a podium to stand behind. I'm traveling on tour with a carry-on. So, you're lucky. Frankly, you are very lucky that this isn't the last event on tour, because it's, it starts to get a little high. I should have a little bubble around me or a police tape around me at some stage as it gets further and further on. But last night, so I don't have a lot of clothes to choose from. And last night, we were in Youngstown, Ohio, giving a talk. And I had one of these, this is called like a lavalier, and what happens is they ask you to hook a kind of a box onto the waistband of your skirt, and the skirt is just a little bit loose. I was about halfway through the talk before I and they had a camera on me and three huge screens up, and I looked and thought, looks a little weird, and my skirt was falling down. So I'm happy to hide behind this. It's just barely hides. It's also incredible for me to be here and to look out at so many of you. When I first started on book tour, well, actually, I didn't start really writing until I was in my 40s, and my first book wasn't published till I was well into my 40s, 45 or so. So I had, actually, older than that, but I had 45 years or so to dream about what a book tour would be like. Now, of course, it involved private jets and hotel suites and champagne and caviar. And so when the first book came out, Still Life, I called up the publisher a couple of weeks before it was actually launched, and I said, I'm ready for my book tour. And he said, who is this? And it's Louise Penny. I've written Still Life. And he said, well, you know, we're not going to send you out on tour because nobody is going to want to see you. And I thought, now that doesn't sound right. So I said to my husband, Michael, you know, maybe we should plan our own tour. So we went out and spent the entire advance on a lunch to discuss the tour. And we designed a tour, and we went to California, and we went to Massachusetts, and we went, you know, a whole lot of places, went to independent bookstores. And you know what? The publisher was right. There was one event in California at quite a well-known bookstore who shall remain nameless, and I counted the number of people in the event, and it came to zero. The worst, though, was in Boston, where one person showed up. Now, you know, it's not too bad if you do an event and nobody shows up. There's Michael, there is a terribly embarrassed bookseller, and there's me. So then we can just pretend that it didn't happen. You know, if you hold a book event in the woods and nobody shows up, so then Michael and I can go out for dinner and we can say, pretend this is all part of the grand long-range plan. Thank God nobody showed up. Our plan is unfolding exactly as we had hoped. The problem comes when one person shows up, right? So then she's sitting there, and now I have to talk. And she knows that she's all alone in the room. I know she's all alone in the room. We're both wishing she would just die. So it's an incredible feeling for me. Now you can imagine. I mean, I'm standing up in front of you, almost 60 years of age, and my dream has come true, and I am looking at a room full of smiling faces, and I at this stage, I may not have to tour. I don't know for sure. I come out because I want to look at your faces and thank you for giving me my dream. And I am happy beyond anything I have any right to feel. So thank you so much for all of this. I started writing, as I said, when I was 45, but I wanted to be a writer since the age of 8. And I remember the moment I realized I wanted to be a writer. I was a very fearful child. I was afraid of everything. I was afraid of the morning dew. I was afraid of heights. I was afraid of holes. I was afraid of everything. The thing I would think I was most afraid of, and this isn't unusual, was spiders. I think a lot of people are and were. Where I most wanted to be in the world, the only place I really felt safe was in my bedroom. The door closed, lying on the bed with a book. Now, I have to tell you, that is still my happy place. I suspect I'm not alone in that. Michael calls me a horizontalist because I spend most of my day is in search of getting my feet up. It got to the stage where, as a child, when I was bad, which wasn't very often, but every now and then when I was bad, as punishment, my mother would send me outside to play. So I was lying on my bed reading Charlotte's Web. Now, it is possible I was a slightly slow child, because I was about halfway through Charlotte's Web before I realized that Charlotte was a spider. Now, to be fair, I think I knew that Charlotte was a spider. I must have known Charlotte was a spider. What happened in that moment, it really was a moment of grace. I believe that sincerely. In that moment, my fear of spiders was lifted because I realized I loved Charlotte and I wanted nothing bad to happen to her. So for a child whose entire existence was prescribed by what was the least fearful thing to do that day, to have the most fearful thing lifted was magic beyond imagining and was so powerful, and I understood in that instant the power of words to heal. And I wanted part of that. And from that moment to this, I have been a lifelong reader, devoted to stories. I read everything and still do. I read cereal boxes. I read, my favorite is actually gummy bear bags. That's probably best not to know what's in gummy bears, so forget that. I also knew I wanted to be a writer from that moment on. But of course, a fearful child, not every fear was lifted. I became a fearful adolescent and became a relatively fearful adult. And one of my fears was that suppose I tried to write and couldn't. Then what would happen? Then I would lose my dream. Not only would I lose the ability to write a book, but I would lose the dream, and I couldn't afford to do that. So I went into an ancillary career as a journalist, and I loved it, and I really enjoyed it, and it turned out to be wonderful training for what came later. But it was really, again, driven by so much in my life, which was driven by fear. And then I reached a stage, and I think many women reach the stage, and I suspect men do as well, but I can only speak from my own experience. I was about 35. And had married Michael by then, and I was tired. I was tired of being a journalist. I was tired of covering disasters. I was tired of listening to sad and angry people. I was tired of the worldview that I was developing. And I came home one day, and Michael said the most wonderful thing. He said, if you would like to quit work in order to write that book you've always wanted to write, which proved that he had been listening after all. What he said next was almost as beautiful as the first time he said, I love you. He said, I will support you. When someone says, I love you, that's the most amazing thing to hear, but I will support you carries with it all sorts of promises, of practical things. And thank God he meant financially. Because I can get emotional support from my women friends. I want the money. And he meant it, but I did it, made a terrible, so I said, yes, please. But I made a terrible strategic error. I got on CBC Radio where I was hosting live current affairs programs, and I announced that I was going to quit work in order to write a book. Turns out it may be best to say that after you've written the book. I may have also, it's just possible I intimated that I was going to write the best book ever written. So then I suffered 5 years of writer's block. 5 years. I ate gummy bears and I watched Oprah Winfrey. 3 years would have been all right, but 5 seemed excessive, even to me. I got to the stage where Michael, poor man, was afraid to ask me how my day was going. He'd come home from work and he'd feel the television warm. They'd best not to ask. It was a little bit like my mother after I passed the age of 30 and I hadn't married yet. And it was like a curtain came down. She stopped asking me, have you met any nice men? Have you met any nice women? You know, are there any farm animals you like? She just stopped asking. And the same with Michael. He just couldn't ask anymore. But you know, still life got written. And I realized from a career of covering disasters that no disaster happens. It might appear to happen out of the blue, but it doesn't. And when you look back and do a kind of a postmortem on it, you realize that it really is a series of much smaller, often invisible events, that if you remove any one of them, the final event wouldn't have happened. If you left 5 minutes earlier or later, if you wore blue instead of green, if you'd turned left instead of, all that. But same thing with wonderful events. They don't happen out of the blue either, at least in my experience. It's a whole bunch of the little kind of grace notes along the way. When I look back on how I went from being paralyzed to having still life, I can see a few things that didn't appear to be as significant as they turned out to be. One was that Michael went into semi-retirement. We decided to move out of Montreal and move to a village quite close to the Vermont border that, not completely coincidentally, resembles Three Pines. If we hadn't done that, there would be no books. There might have been some other books, maybe, but certainly not those books. My characters are sons and daughters of that soil, and it was important, it was necessary for me. As Liz wrote, they are love letters to the place that I choose to live. The other thing is that I fell in with a group of women, which makes it sound like they were a gang, but they weren't. Who are all artists. They created one way or another, poets and painters and a dancer and an actor. And they'd formed a group called Les Girls. And once a month, they invited me to join them, would get together and would have café au lait and croissant in the local bistro. And they would discuss their creative process and what they were working on. Now, I still wasn't writing. And at no stage did these amazing women make me earn my place at that table. They were patient and they were generous and they allowed me to witness their own process without needing to contribute. And I went to some art openings and I went to some one women shows and I went to some dance recitals that they had created and put on, and I saw some amazing triumphs. And I saw some stinkers. But you know what I saw? I saw that the next morning, no matter what happened, they got out of bed, they put their clothes on, and they walked down the street magnificent, independent of what had happened the night before. That success or failure wasn't going to kill them. What was killing me and what would have killed them was not trying. And I hate to tell you, I was well into my 40s before I learned that lesson, and they taught me that. The final thing that had to happen was that I looked on my bedside table. You know, something as banal as that. And there, stacked up, like many of you, I read small c Catholically. I read everything. I read fiction and nonfiction and genre and non-genre and whatnot. But well represented was crime fiction. And I had another aha moment, like Charlotte's a Spider. I realized that I needed to write a book I would read. That's it. Not for anyone else. Not even a book that would be published, just a book I would love to read. And I remember just sitting down softly on the side of the bed and going, that's it. And feeling freed up and realizing too at that moment the weight of expectation that I had placed on myself. The millstone, the anchor I had been lugging around that had wrapped itself around my throat and my creativity and frozen me, was the expectations of others. That I needed the approval of others, probably all my life, but certainly over this. And how stultifying that was. And it wasn't being put on me by anyone else. It was what I was doing to myself. I needed to write a fabulous book so that my mother would be proud, so that my brothers would realize I wasn't a complete moron, so that the teachers who had failed me would rue the day they gave me a C, so that my colleagues, best of all, would be jealous, because why else bother doing it unless they were going to be jealous? So the woman who voiced my GPS would recalculate. And I suddenly realized that wasn't the contract with my 8-year-old self. The contract wasn't that the book be brilliant. It wasn't that it even be published, just that it be finished. And so I sat down that day and I drew a map, and I still have it. It's a silly thing done in pencil that I think is probably fading by now, but it's up on a cork board in my study. And it's the circle, that's the village green, and then another circle, and that's where the homes were. And I started, the first thing I created, what else would you create but the bookstore? That was the very first thing in Three Pines. I created a village I would live in. The first thing you need is a bookstore. Very hard on creating the bookstore was the bistro. And then after that was the boulangerie, the bakery, because just in case the bistro ran out. And then I created characters I would choose as friends. And finally, I created a main character, Gamache, who I would marry. Every decision I made was selfish. But there was a wonderful breakthrough in my life, because much of my life I had also felt, and I think this is the fear that I had felt, was I had, in order to cope with the fear, what I did was I created my own island. So I had felt for much of my life that I was on an island looking at the mainland and feeling safe, but becoming increasingly lonely and isolated. And I longed to join the mainland. And at some stage, I managed to do that. And I realized that nothing separates me from anyone else. There is nothing extraordinary about me. And I'm not saying that so that people say, oh, yes, there is. Genuinely, it is a massive comfort and a saving grace for me to realize that I am simply one among equals, that we all have our gifts, and I just happen to be lucky that I found Armand, the others. So that I realize that if I write for myself, just from my heart and from a place of joy and gratitude and awareness of how lucky I am, if I create a village I would want to live in, there's a fairly good chance others would want to join me in that village. And so that's what happened. Now, I'm going to skip ahead and say, and then the book was written. So then the next day I wrote the book. I can go into that process if you want, but it's all a bit of a blur. But what happened then was when I finished and I wrote the end, which was, as you can imagine, as thrilling a moment. If the meteorite had hit at that moment, I wasn't ready to die, but it would have squashed a very happy person, a fulfilled person. You know, because fear is a terrible thing. It's been a terrible thing in my life. It has stolen and come close to stealing so much that has given me joy. But fear has ruled much of my life. One of my favorite quotes, and I use it in the previous book, The Long Way Home, was Seamus Heaney's last words, the Irish poet. And his final words, you're probably familiar with it, were to his wife. And he said, noli temere, which means be not afraid. And I have a poster now that says, noli temere. It's framed, and it's right in front of where I write. So that every day I look at them and say, be not afraid. You can do it. You can do it. Be not afraid to challenge, to push. You know, having created Three Pines and those characters, it's not enough for me to just settle in and say, well, that job's done. Now I'm just going to continue to write the same novel over and over again. Be not afraid means stretching myself, taking risks, risking failing, which is something I had been so afraid of all my life. But I realized that if I risk failing, then I'm not living. I'm not stretching myself. I'm not meeting all of my potential. So I finished writing Still Life. But then the problem was, of course, I wanted it published, but I didn't know how to do it. So I went into the local independent bookstore, and I ran into, she was a new clerk. She just started. And I introduced myself, and I said, "You'll never believe what has just happened. I've finished my first book." And she said, "Oh, my God, that is fantastic. Congratulations. Would you like to buy another one?" Now, if I was going to go into publishing because my ego demanded it, that was a real shot across the bow. So I just want to make sure I'm not taking up too much of your time. What I want to do is take you to how it actually got published, because I sent it out to everyone, every agent, every publisher, everybody. This was before electronic submissions. This was in 2003, 2004. And nobody wanted it. Nobody. I could have shot it into outer space. It would have been an intergalactic failure. Nobody wanted it. And you know, the worst of it is, you send it out, and you send self-addressed stamped envelopes at the time, and it barely even left my hot little hands, and I was checking the mailbox, have they written yet, with the million-dollar check and the private jet. And what was worse is that there was no rejection. There was silence. Silence. It was heartbreaking. I, though, had forgotten that I had entered a contest in Great Britain put on by the Crime Writers Association, the CWA, and it was for the best unpublished first mystery, which is really an extremely generous award for these other crime writers to create, because they didn't want anyone to suffer the way they had. So it was a kind of a clearinghouse for unpublished first writers. It turns out of 800 entries worldwide, they had shortlisted Still Life. And I remember opening up the email, and I must have screamed because Michael and the dog, when I regained consciousness, there they were. And what they did was they said, the CWA said, "You're invited to the awards gala in London." Now I have the chance to finally be in a room with all the people I had been trying to get at for 2 years. So Michael and I go over there. This is where my journalism training came in very well, because I realized there was a very real danger that I would spend those precious 2 hours talking to another author, thinking that they might be an agent, which you don't want to do. So I got in touch with the top bookstores in London, and I said, "I need your help. I'm coming, blah, blah, blah. Who are the top three agents in the UK for crime fiction?" And they winnowed it down to three names, and they gave it to me. So I went off to this gala, and the first person wasn't there. The second person was not at all interested in speaking to me. And the third person was drunk. And then I didn't win. I thought, oh my God, so poor Michael, he got me back to the hotel room and I curled into a little ball, and 4 days later he hosed me down and said, "You really should get up." This was around Christmas time, and we had been invited to what's called a sale of goods by a friend of a friend, someone we didn't know at all. And this was, apparently it's not uncommon in London, where people hold cocktail parties in their homes and then sell items. Yeah, I know, it's kind of silly, isn't it? You sort of hope that there's items that they themselves owned and not, But it was actually, this is someone who had an association with a co-op in Afghanistan. So she would sell the items for these women and then send the money back to Afghanistan. So it was really very interesting. But I didn't want to go because I was busy being depressed, which is very exhausting. Though Michael finally actually got me out of bed and got me, I don't know what he, made sure I was dressed in something. And off we went, and there was this beautiful pashmina on a table. And I reached out at the at this cocktail. I reached out for it, and this claw reached out at the same time and grabbed it. So now we're doing what can only happen, I think, in the UK, and that is that two very English people are playing tug of war and pretending it's not happening. It's nice weather. And finally she turns to me and she says, "Well, who are you?" And I said, "Well, I'm Louise Penny," like that would matter. And she said the most extraordinary thing. She said, "I have your name on a post-it note on my computer." And I said, "Well, who are you?" And she said, "Teresa Chris." And that was the third name on the list. In all of London. In that entire cocktail party, there must have been 100 people there, 99 of which I didn't speak to. It's shocking. She ended up being my agent, and that novel, Still Life, that nobody wanted, ended up translated into 27 languages now. The same book, the same novel, everybody turned down. So that's how I came to be standing in front of you. What I would love to do now is open it up for questions, if it's all right for you, with you, because I could prattle on all day, but I want to hear what you're interested in hearing about. What I would ask is, because the novels are so intertwined at this stage, if you're going to ask a question, you could try not to give, say, "Why did you make so-and-so the murderer?" That's never a good question. In fact, I actually think the safest is if you just, a string of compliments, really. By far the best. So Liz, you have a... You either have a question or you feel a song coming on.
Both. I'll come around to people who have questions. Right here.
Hi. Will you stand up so everyone can see you?
I was interested in you talking about your efforts and your non-writing for a long time. And I was thinking about a book that came out... sometime in the last 2 years called The Confidence Gap, which is by Claire Shipman and Katty Kay, about women's confidence. And I wondered if gender is a factor, that as a woman it was a fear of failure or ways in which male writers may not feel, they may feel, I don't know. Just
you
how
know,
would you
that's
comment?
Very, she's wondering about, oh, I mean, you heard her, she had a microphone. Let me do the translation. What she was saying was that I was beautiful. No, she was wondering, obviously, about if there's a difference between the confidence of men and women. To be honest, I don't know. All I can speak to is my own massive well of insecurity. And there may very well be men, I think, show their lack of confidence in different ways. I think we withdraw, and I think often they move forward. You know, they become aggressive, perhaps, and we withdraw. I don't know if that's completely true, but I've seen a little bit of that. But I do know it's something that a lot of women, in the books, I'm Clara. So, and I recognize Clara's insecurities. When I write about, I'm not an artist, a visual artist, I don't paint. So what I write about, when I write about her or Ruth's process, or in, again, The Long Way Home, I quote Robert Frost and the letter to a friend where he talks about his creative process. And in it, he says that for him, a poem begins as a lump in the throat. And Clara, this is something that Ruth talks about. And she says for her, a poem also begins as a lump in the throat. And Clara says for her, that's her work of art begins, and for me, a book begins as a lump in the throat, a strongly held emotion. So I understand all of Clara's fears and insecurities. At 3 p.m, what she has created is brilliant, and at 3 a.m, it's a piece of something soft and smelly. That's how I feel about the books. It's Oh, it's a very scary. Noli temere, noli temere.
Hi, Louise. I'm wondering if you remember what novel, unpublished novel, won that CWA award that you didn't win and should have.
No, but I remember her name. I won't. Well, you know, nothing. Her name was Ellen Gum. Yes. Yes. No. I wish. Yes. No. I try to tell people. Michael and I, because we were so taken with our experience before and after, and what a pivotal moment that was, and what a generous thing it was for them. We were inspired by that and created a similar award in Canada for best unpublished novel, because we didn't, again, much like the CWA writers, didn't want anyone to have to go through that. I came so close, I cannot, if I hadn't been shortlisted for the CWA, I felt I had run out of options. I mean, it was going under the bed for my heirs to find one day and burn.
So you're beautiful, you're talented, you're inspirational.
Oh, for sure! No!
Get that out of the way. Now, more importantly, I think all of us, you made us all fall in love with Armand, but hearing you speak this morning, I'd like to hear a little bit more about Michael, if you don't mind,
yes.
Because he just sounds like a wonder.
He is, yes, yes. He's. Do you know, I got very lucky. I didn't meet him till later in life, and he had just lost his first wife to cancer. He himself was a cancer doctor, and he had just lost his first wife to cancer. He had he was a professor at McGill and head of hematology at the Montreal Children's. So he was really the doctor you never, ever, ever want to have to meet. He dealt with children who were very, very seriously ill. And I remember the first Christmas we were together, and there was a party at the Montreal Children's, and there were all the children running around and the parents, and I was at one side of the room, and it was a big room. And I looked across, and there was Michael standing there, and he had his bow tie on, and he very slowly turned around so that he was facing the wall. It was such an extraordinary thing to do. So I went around and I said, "Are you all right?" And I put my hand on his back and he was crying. And he said, "He knows which children will see another Christmas." Oh, I know. Well, I said, "Marry me! Have my children!" So Armand is actually, you know, I was feeling quite proud of myself having created Armand out of the blue. This, aren't I brilliant? And then over breakfast one day, I looked at him and realized I had created nothing. I had simply stolen Michael. As some of you might know, he's suffering from dementia now, which is not my fault, I want to say. But it was interesting because, as many people who have been through this probably know, by the time he was diagnosed, we knew something had gone wrong. And we had actually gone in, Michael and I, to have him tested. And he tested normal. And then 6 months later, he no longer tested normal. And we asked him, how could he have tested normal when it was so clear that things were wrong? And they explained that one of the problems with the test is that if you start off smarter than normal, what Michael did was he dropped to normal, which is a bit of a comfort because I know that if I ever got dementia, it would be... I'm like clinging on to the bottom of normal as it is. It would be immediately obvious. So one of the first things we did for this tour was a big event, a fundraiser for early onset. Michael doesn't have early onset, he's older, but early onset carries a whole bunch of its own tragic issues. But there was an organization in Vancouver that helped people with early onset dementia and Alzheimer's. So we did a big fundraiser for them in Vancouver, and that's clearly become a major focus. And Michael was great when he was first diagnosed. He said, you know, I want to step out and talk about it and make it clear. So we spent a few months just sort of absorbing the news ourselves and then started talking about it because there's still a lot of shame attached to it, and people are unclear about what it means and fearful, and understandably so. So Michael was very brave and said, I want to talk about it. I want to say, you know, it strikes everybody. And you know, he's a remarkable man, noli to marry.
Hi, Louise.
Oh, there you go, Rita.
You are gorgeous.
Oh, honey.
Some inquiring minds at our table would like to know, are you, in fact, the poet, Ruth Zardo?
Oh, now those are two separate questions. Do I write the poetry or am I Ruth?
No, do you write the poetry?
Yeah, you better be careful, because otherwise I'll tell you that.
No, I said, are you the poet?
Proving one of the points.
Thank you.
No, I don't write the poetry. If you look at the very beginning, there's a permissions page, and it will talk about the specific poems, the names of the poems, but also the publications. And most of the poems come from Margaret Atwood, as it turns out. I don't know, is she going to be in Politics and Prose this?
No, not
this year, yes. She's got a new book coming out. But it's all, the Ruth's poetry is, much of it is hers. Used, of course, with permission, because you don't want to piss off Margaret Atwood. I think in Canada it's illegal.
I have to say that I really enjoy your Facebook page as well, because I love all your updates and I love you writing about your writing process and all the drafts and that kind of thing. But what I really wanted to know is that right now it seems like you're doing a book a year. Is that?
Yes.
Is that because you want to, or is that because the your publisher wants you to?
Or do I have an endless well of murder?
Yes, exactly. Don't stop writing, but I was just wondering if...
Well, I've always done a book a year. When I... My agent, Teresa, as I've just described, is British, and I think maybe because I'm Canadian, when I'm speaking with someone who is British, and we have, you know, we can be a little insecure and have a bit of a chip on our shoulders, particularly when hanging around people who are British. And they're pretty clear that we should have a chip on our shoulders. They place it there. And so when Teresa is speaking to me, there's always, what I hear is an implied, you idiot. So when she called me up to say, Louise, the most wonderful thing's happened. I have sold 3 books. So I said, oh my God, Teresa, that's wonderful. Mine and who else's? It never occurred to me that she would commit me to 3 books. And she said, Louise, you idiot. They're all yours. Which was just petrified me, because it had taken me, as you know, 45 years to write the first. And then I had a year to write the second. And frankly, I thought the first was an act of God. I seriously did. I didn't know. You know, how do you go and knock on God's door again and say, by the way, my agent, who you know is an idiot, would you mind? You know, how do you find the burning bush again? So I started writing the second. But this, what happened was, because I was being handed my dream, everything I had ever wanted, I mean, a 3-book publishing contract not from Bob's Mimeograph and, you know, car repair agency down the road, but from, you know, a major New York publisher. And I was overwhelmed with fear again. And I started writing, and I in fact wrote the entire first draft, and it was awful. And I knew it was awful because I had lost my way. I had lost the joy, I had lost the purpose, I had lost the heart of Three Pines, I had lost the gratitude. I was fearful, and I was again fell back into the old comfort zone, which is write to please others. Write so that the editor will like it, the agent will like it, the readers will like it, rather than just writing with an open spirit. And so I was very, very afraid. I was also afraid, too, that the writer's block would overcome me before I would have a chance to fix any of this. So I went to a therapist, because I knew I needed help. And she said something that changed my life. She said, the wrong person is writing this book, which was not initially helpful. So I asked, who then, if not me, should be writing it? It She said, your critic is writing it. She said, what you need to do is you need to thank the critic, you need to bless the critic, you need to show the critic the door for the first draft. And your creative spirit needs to write the first draft. Just write. It won't be perfect, it can't be perfect. Write with joy, with gratitude, with pleasure, just write. If you want to write 10 pages on a rug, write it. It doesn't matter, because when you come to the end of the first draft, you'll invite the critic back in. And the critic will shape and decide what works and what doesn't. But you have to leave space for inspiration. And that was so freeing. She gave me permission to make mistakes. And so to explore. And that's what I do now. My first drafts really are big pieces of you know what. And they have to be. And it still scares me a little bit because I'm sort of afraid that I won't find the nuggets inside there. But I know that they're there. I'm getting better at that. My fears have shifted. They're no longer quite the same as that. And then I take 4 or 5 drafts, sometimes more, to winnow down and shape and whatnot. The other thing that happened was, again, it needs to be a cavalcade of smaller events. That was actually a big event. And the other thing that happened was that Teresa called from London and asked, well, how's it going, Louise? And I said, oh, Teresa, I'm very afraid of it. And she said, oh, for God's sake, it's not War and Peace you're writing. And she hung up. I sort of needed that. It felt like cartoons, the frying pan in the face. And I always now, I think of her as having this vat of martinis and a cigar. And she's wiping ash off her bazoom. So the next day, when she'd sobered up, she called back. And she said, okay, now here's the thing. The thing is that most authors can write 1,000 words a day. Most books are about 90 to 100,000, roughly. Ergo, you should have it written in 90 days or so. Now, that was very helpful because for me, again, who thought that the whole thing was magic, suddenly it gives it structure. It never even occurred to me. If I write X number of words, it can be 1,000, it can be 500, it could be 10, but eventually, if I write that often enough, I will reach the end. There is a way to do it. The final thing that had to happen was that I read Douglas Coupland's biography of Terry Fox. I don't know if you know Terry Fox. He was a young Canadian, struck with cancer, lost a leg to cancer, and he decided to run across the country to raise money and awareness. And he got halfway across, and he gathered celebrities as he went because people initially didn't even know he was doing it. And by the time he ended, he was rightly a Canadian hero. They got halfway through, and the cancer returned, and he eventually died. But Douglas Coupland was given access to his diaries by the family, and he published the diaries with photographs. And I read it at this time, and in it, Terry Fox describes, and he was, I think, 16 or 17 at the time, so wise, and he said he didn't set out every day to run across the nation. If he did, he'd be overwhelmed. What he did was he just ran to the next corner. Then he ran to the next corner. And he knew if he did that often enough, he would reach British Columbia. He would reach the end. And all those three things for me combined to understand how I could write the second book. And I threw away my first draft, and I started again with joy in my heart. And I started writing, and I finished, and I went back, and I invited the critic back in, and I shaped it. And it was the second book of Fatal Grace, and it was the first book to win the Agatha Award. So I have such a fondness for that book. But that now I write a book a year. That was such a long but really riveting answer to that question. But also let me just add that what happened with the last contract was that I said I can't write a book a year anymore. I can't write to that deadline. I can't. Because I don't want it to become a sausage factory. It can't, these books cannot, that's not the purpose of it. So God bless the publishers. They said, all right, you'll have a 3-book contract, but turn them in whenever. Being so contrary, now that I don't have to, I do.
Hello.
Hi.
I too want to thank you so much for your contributions to Facebook. You share your life with us. You share your thoughts, you share your dreams, and you share that beautiful area with us.
Oh,
thank you.
Yes, thank
I look
you.
Forward to it. My question would be the little duck.
Ah.
Where does the inspiration come from, the little duck? I dearly love it.
Rosa.
Yes.
Now, someone unfamiliar with the, it was duck, she said. anyone unfamiliar with the books is wondering, what in the world have I gotten myself into? Rosa is Ruth Zardo, the poet's duck. Now, that was an example of the completely unexpected. I did not sit down to write the third book where Rosa first appears, which is The Cruelest Month, with a duck in mind. and you know, it's certainly not the sort of thing you tell your publisher. You know, I think I'm going to give the poet a duck, because, you know, then they tear up the contract. But it was set at Easter time, and there was an Easter egg hunt, and in the hunt, one of the nests gets disturbed, and the mother duck won't nurture the eggs, and so she abandons them, and Ruth finds the eggs and takes them home, these two eggs. And everyone assumes, of course, that Ruth being Ruth, who's, you know, that clearly she was going to eat them, because what else would Ruth do? But she ended up hatching the ducks. And it allowed me to talk about a couple of things. That Ruth, like most of us, had heard that ducks, when first hatched, will bond with the first thing they see. But what she didn't realize is it goes in the other direction, too, that she bonded with these ducklings. But it also allowed me to talk about something that I feel fairly strongly about, and that's, you know, sort of the road to hell, paved with good intentions, that a duck or a chicken or a goose or a human being sometimes needs to struggle in order to thrive. You can't, it's wrong to help a duck out of the shell. It needs, in order to develop its lungs, its wings, its strength, it has to fight its way out. Now, Ruth sees one of the ducks struggling and maybe not being able to make it, and as an act of kindness, she thinks, she helps it out. And then we see what happens. But it's one of those things, just a little slice of life, something that shouldn't, that the life of a duck should not matter, but, you know, every life matters. And it becomes a lesson for Ruth. And unfortunately, it reinforces for Ruth what she already believes, and that's that kindness is a dangerous thing, and to never show it. So she's kind of born inside out. Most of us, the books are about many things, probably least among them murder. But one of the things they're about is the duality of the beautiful place, as, you know, Stephen King talked about, and the violation of murder. The public image we all, and thank God, that we all walk around with, and our inner thoughts, the gap between what we say and what we feel. And so we have that veneer, but Ruth is inside out. She keeps all of her worst thoughts on the outside and keeps her goodness inside.
Thank you so much for your wonderful books. I love them.
Thank you.
I was wondering, what inspired you to step outside of Three Pines and write the beautiful mystery about the monastery? Which I loved that book. But I love all your books, but it inspired me to go out and buy a CD of Gregorian chants. After I read that.
What became clear to me, my initial idea was to set all the books in Three Pines. But by the third book, it became clear that this little village would not sustain the murder rate. And it was getting increasingly difficult to describe it as idyllic when obviously. So I decided that after that, every second book, for the most part, I don't want to be rigid, but every second book would be set outside of Three Pines. And so the fourth book, A Rule Against Murder, is set close to Three Pines, but in a lodge, a manoir, a hotel on the edge of a lake, with some scenes back in Three Pines. And the fifth book is set back in Three Pines. The sixth book is mostly in Quebec City with some Three Pines. By the eighth book, The Beautiful Mystery, I thought it was time to take Gamache and his second-in-command, Beauvoir, right out of Three Pines and see what happens. And I loved writing that book. And for many, many reasons, I felt I had to step back as well, sort of cleanse the palate a little bit, give Three Pines a chance to repopulate. And then when I went back to write How the Light Gets In, it was an it was like coming home. It was a wonderful feeling. But I must tell you about writing The Beautiful Mystery. I had to research it. So there's a monastery fairly close to where we live of semi-cloistered monks who sing. And I always liked that duality of the monks who have taken a vow of silence who are famous for their voices. They become famous for these Gregorian chants. So I wrote to them and said, my name's Louise Penny, I'm a crime writer, I would like to set a mystery, murder mystery in a monastery, not thinking that I would hear back. Well, Frère Raymond wrote back and said, bonjour, Madame Penny, that's wonderful, why don't you come stay with us? And I'm thinking, that doesn't make sense. That should not be the answer. So I wrote back to him again and said, bonjour, Frère Raymond, merci, my name's Louise Penny. He's so patient, he wrote back and said, I know, I got it the first time. You're welcome to come and stay. So there's the monastery with the monks who are Benedictine, and then there's a nunnery on the property as well. So Michael and I packed an overnight bag, and I said, now obviously it's you know, they're cloistered monks, so you're going to be with the monks with the hair shirts, and I will be with the nuns. We'll be making cookies. So we showed up, and didn't the monks allow both of us to not only stay in the monastery but stay together? I couldn't believe it. I'm not sure they told the Pope. But they let us stay, and I wish I had taken a photograph of it, because they stay in cells, of course, or their rooms are called cells. And the cell that they put us in, there's a little plaque outside, it's called the presidential cell. Imagine. They gave us extraordinary access. They were wonderful. And to be honest, at first I was not really plugged into Gregorian chants or to the religious day, the rhythm of a religious day. But as the day progressed and we went to more and more of their services, you know, I began to sort of fall into that. The cares of the world disappeared, slipped away. And by the last service of the day, and it was dark, and it was just, and the monks came in, each holding a candle. It was, I'm getting chills even now. It wasn't exciting, it wasn't thrilling, it was a sense of such deep peace that I'd never felt before. And that's what I tried to transmit in the writing of it, this place of such extraordinary peace and of brotherly love, of a community that cares for each other and believes that the Gregorian chants are the word of God and the voice of God, and then what happens when that again is violated. But I must say, at the end, I went and spoke to the abbot, because I wanted him to be clear about what I was going to do, and I wasn't totally sure that they grasped it. And so the abbot agreed to meet with me, and I said, now you do understand, if I set a murder in this monastery, that means one of the monks will be murdered. And he's, you know, his brow is beginning to come together, and he's, okay. But it also means, mon père, that one of the monks did it. Well, you should have seen the face just closed right down. And he said, no, I can't allow that. I cannot allow you to set a crime novel, which is really the answer I had expected all along. They'd already been generous enough. So I, being godlike in my power, resurrected and created an order of monks called the Gilbertines. But the abbot showed Michael and me out, I think probably to make sure we did leave. And at the door, he turned to me and he said, you know, a murder in a Benedictine monastery is just very, it's not going to happen. It is extremely unlikely. Now the Trappists.
Oh,
I think that was my favorite moment of 10 years.
Hi. You are beautiful and smart.
Oh, thank you.
Ruth is my favorite character.
Ruth?
Because, yeah, she seems the most vulnerable of everybody who lives there.
Good for you, yes. Yeah.
My question is, if a movie was ever made or a TV series, who would you want to play Gamache?
Ah, well, as it turns out, one has been made.
I know, but I haven't been able to track it down.
Yes, yes. They cast Nathaniel Parker as Gamache. He was Linley in the Elizabeth George. Now, I have to tell you that, you know, in Linley he was a certain age. Now he's 10 or 15 years older than you probably remember seeing him in the Linley. He has aged very nicely, ladies. I went to the set on the first day, and he was there, and I was, I think I might have embarrassed myself. but he was wonderful, because he came up to me, and we chatted, and he said, I know that I am not your idea of Gamache. And I thought that took a lot of character on his part, a lot of courage to face it head on. And we discussed it, and I said, you know, you're not. But what I do believe is that I don't want a caricature. An actor needs to make the character his own. And John Thaw wasn't Colin Dexter's Morse. If you read Morse and look at the first, they're not the same. But he did such a wonderful job of inhabiting the character that, and Dexter liked it so much, that as the series went on, if you read later Morse's, he begins to look like John Thaw. Art imitating life. So it was more important to me. It's important, obviously, that he has the same general characteristics, but like, you know, a 25-year-old would not be Gamache. But it's more important that he capture the essence of the man. But, you know, I don't really know. It would be very difficult. Do you have someone in mind?
No.
You don't?
I'm ready with my money.
No. Does anyone have anyone in mind for Gamache? No, it would be difficult, very difficult to cast. But I have to think it would be a wonderful role for an older actor, if you could. Yes, we just recently lost, as perhaps, who here listens to the audio? Yeah, we recently lost our narrator, Ralph Cosham died, which was a real, real shame, because he became the voice of Gamache for many people. Yeah.
I absolutely love Three Pines. I so want to retire there with all your characters. And I can.
There's some empty homes.
Oh, that's right. Not the Hadley house, though. and I can see Gamache as Michael and you as Clara, sorry. But where on earth did Ruth come from? You astonish me, shock me every time I read what comes out of Ruth's mouth.
Oh, Ruth, yes.
Who is she based on?
Well, you know, for my sins, I actually know two people who are Ruth. The interesting thing is that neither of them sees it. Neither of them has come up and said, I think I'm Ruth. No. So they're... Neither of them, though, is a poet. Both of them will speak their mind. They have no filter between what they think and what they say. And sometimes it's the truth, and sometimes it's just cruel. What I liked and what I wanted to do with Ruth was not make her just cruel. That's why I gave her the poetry. And I read a lot of poetry. I don't write it at all. My poetry is like an angst-ridden 12-year-old. It's awful. It wouldn't, you know, it's... anyway. But I read a lot of poetry, and so I wanted to make her a poet, because we all have a saving grace, and Ruth's saving grace happens to be a certain insight into herself, but also into human nature. So I love writing her, and I love writing her... interactions with all sorts of people, including Jean-Guy, who are both, because both she and Jean-Guy are wounded.
Yeah. We have time for two more questions.
Okay.
when I read your writing, I just so admire the struggle to get all those beautiful words down and in the right sequence. After you struggle with all the drafts you've talked about, when do you know this is it? It's done. Stop tweaking it. Yeah. Stop rewriting it. Stop editing it.
That's a wonderful question. When do you know it's enough is enough? And you know, it's almost, I know it sounds sort of silly, but you sort of you just kind of know. At some stage, you just know that I could do it forever. And still now, I'll go through the books trying to find a reading or whatever, and I'll find a clunky sentence and think, how did that get through? How did that happen? But at some stage, now I've also gotten better. I used to believe that I had to send in, while my first and second and third drafts couldn't be perfect, I knew the final drafts weren't going to be perfect, but I had to send in as perfect a draft as I could to my editors, or they would know that I couldn't do it. You know, they would send me back to Idaho or wherever, Saskatchewan. So that I, kept working at it, Now I understand what a collaboration. Such an interesting process because it is both extremely individual and needs to be. You can't write a book by committee, or most people can't. James Patterson can, but I can't. But at some stage, I need to trust my editors. And so I get it, I get it as good as I possibly can, but I know it's not perhaps what it could be. And I have a wonderful editor in Hope Dellen, who's actually went to university in Washington and speaks so highly of politics and prose, she almost fainted when she found out. I wish she was here today. But she's insightful, and I would be foolish not to pay attention to what they say. We don't always agree. She gives me a lot of notes, and some I agree with and some I don't, and we discuss it and sometimes argue, but it's always very civil and with a lot of respect. But I've learned a great deal from my editors.
Okay. Hello, beautiful, brilliant person. You know, your monastery book was one of my favorites because you created such a wonderful atmosphere, and they went away, and they were
Don't talk too much about. Sorry, go on.
No, they went away, and they were away.
Yeah.
And they went on the boat. I've been to Northern Ontario to some of those stony, rocky places like that, and it was so idyllic. Is what I'm trying to say.
Yes, thank you.
And the monastery situation was, and there they were, and then your force of evil appeared. Mm-hmm. And I was furious. I was really mad. I was so mad. It's like, what's he doing here? How could this happen? Now, how did you develop that side of it? We've been talking about the nice characters. What, you've got this cretin.
Yes. Franqueur.
Yes.
Franqueur, which translates into hard heart. Franqueur. Well, again, that was kind of organic. It wasn't when I started Still Life and began to write them, I didn't have the whole, I'm assuming, I won't talk specifically, but I'm assuming you know sort of much of what's already happened. There's police corruption, and I didn't have that specifically in mind. But when it became clear that Gamache needed sort of a counterpart, it's like Paradise Lost. It's the yes, exactly, the yes, so you need the good and the evil. And Gamache was so clearly the good, so he needed someone of equal weight to challenge him and to tempt him. And in that book, at the end, Gamache comes as close as I've written him to actual murder. And I won't say what happens next, but it was very interesting to watch how evil could infiltrate even a good man. And that was interesting for me to see, too. And it comes from partly from my own life, because I have to choose my company wisely, because I can be quite impressionable, way less so than I was as a child, for sure. But still, if I'm around people who are nasty and cruel and negative and fault-finding and gossipy and malicious, I hate to tell you, it may not be very long before I start with that. So I am very careful about the people, the company I keep. I choose to keep the company of decent people, because they bring out the best in me. What, you know, Abraham Lincoln talked about the better angels of our nature. Well, I've been cynical, and it's not a good place for me. So I wanted to see what would happen to Gamache when he was in close quarters with someone who was not only evil but extremely manipulative. So, you know, evil people. There's that wonderful line from Auden, in his elegy to Melville, where he says that evil is unspectacular and always human and shares our bed and eats at our table, and we are introduced to goodness every day among a crowd of faults. And so the book's about a crowd of faults, and it's about the banality of evil as well.
Thank you, Louise.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. I've had the most wonderful time. Thank you. And thank you, Politics and Prose. Thank you.